When it comes to mental health care, we all have a story. And I'm here to share one about my Uncle David. Some of my first memories were going camping with my family on the beach. I don't know why, but I would always try and run away. I was a wild little boy. Who would come and get me? My Uncle David. I'd be giggling as he picked me up in his arms like a little football, bringing me back to the group. I wanted to have muscles like Uncle David. Nobody was as strong as my Uncle David. He'd help me do handstands. And just in case you're wondering, I was 3 in that picture, and I still can't do a handstand. But I can do a headstand with the assistance of my yoga teacher. I remember the big house he had in Agawam, Mass, right next to Six Flags. I'd get excited every time we took that exit off the highway, and you could see the Superman roller coaster high in the sky. It was only fitting because he was my Superman. I played my first video games at his house. I loved swimming in his pool and just wish I could make as big of a splash as he could when he cannonballed into the water. Of course, I can't forget the world's greatest basement that my cousin and I would turn into a WWE wrestling ring, jumping off the couches onto the pillows. I told you, I was a wild little boy. It was all fun and games until it wasn't. The last time I saw my uncle was Mother's Day, junior year of high school. I'll never forget the last words he said as he was walking out the door. "I'll see you in the fall at one of your football games." Unfortunately, he never made it to a game. My Uncle David was dealing with substance use disorder for many years, and he overdosed on heroin. He had 3 great kids, a great wife, big house, my mom, my grandma, a beautiful life on all accounts. It's a stark reminder that mental health can affect anyone. Uncle David is not alone. Overdose is now the leading cause of death for 15 to 49-year-olds in the US. Suicide is high on the list. Alcohol use disorder is high on the list. If I showed you this graph 2 decades ago, cancer was the number one cause of death by far. And while we have a long way to go still on our fight against cancer, at least we're seeing progress. With overdose, suicide, alcohol use disorder, so broad behavioral health, we are literally going backwards. Before I go to the next slide, can you please raise your hand if you have kids? 9% of high school students have attempted suicide. 20% of high school students have seriously considered suicide. Remember all those hands that were just raised? Before we think about why or the solve, let's just take a second to think about that. I almost didn't believe the stat when I first saw it. And unfortunately, the problem doesn't get better. 1 in 5 adults has a mental health issue. 1 in 25 has a serious mental health issue. And less than 50% of people who need care are getting help. Everyone says we have a shortage for providers. They're right and wrong at the same time. The real problem is we have a shortage for providers who take insurance. Less than 50% of providers take even 1. Why are we here? Well, raise your hand if you have a smartphone. First off, good job, Steve Jobs. But the first iPhone came out in 2007. This is 1 year before the Mental Health Parity Act of 2008. Think about that. We had smartphones before we considered mental health a part of healthcare. Even then, many payers didn't truly consider mental health a part of healthcare. Why don't providers take insurance? It's not that they're bad people. They became providers to get their patients better. As Sam was saying, not to deal with contracting, credentialing, verification of benefits. We have to remove that friction. I started to realize just how big of a problem we had at my last company. And no, it was not the sock company. I was selling into large employers for on-site clinic communication, and I kept hearing mental health, mental health, mental health. That's when I got connected to my co-founder. He described what he wanted to do, and that he unfortunately lost several friends to overdose and suicide. Of course, that hit close to home. Then I started doing research and realized we're spending $300 billion a year on behavioral health, and we're literally going backwards. Doing what matters is important to me, and that's why making mental health care work for everyone is something I'm passionate about bringing to as many people as possible. PATH is helping with the path to progress, no pun intended. We are a healthcare provider group enabled by technology. I picked those words very carefully. I picked that sequence very carefully. We are not an aggregator. We are not a tech company. We are not a marketplace. We are a healthcare provider group with over 8,000 providers across the country. And this is about getting the right patient to the right provider at the right time. Until we change the way we deliver healthcare in the US, we could have a whole other conference on that. You have to work within the system in order to make mental health care work for everyone. As Mark Hansberry from Health Partners said on Monday, no offense to anyone in the room, but I don't get inspiration on consumer experience from within healthcare. I look to retail for inspiration. It's almost as if he knew I was going to present this slide. On Friday, last Friday, before my travels, I'm at Target getting a few things, and I realized, wait a second, I need new razor blades so I can be freshly shaven for all of you. I go to the aisle and I'm like, wait, it's half the cost on Amazon. It's 8 a.m., I have an 8 p.m. flight, so you're probably thinking, I just sucked it up and paid double. Wrong. Amazon has given us this beautiful thing called same-day delivery. I take out my phone, hit a few buttons, and within 15 minutes, I'm walking back to Target, and by 2 p.m., the razor blades are at my door. Imagine if it was that simple to find a mental health provider that matches your preferences, takes your insurance, and has availability within days. I haven't had a car in years. Why? Because Uber has democratized having a personal driver. Anywhere I am, take out my phone, hit a few buttons, I'm on my way. Amazon did not invent books. They definitely didn't invent razor blades. Uber didn't invent taxis. They didn't invent drivers. They simply made it more efficient to get what you want when you wanted it. Similarly, PATH didn't invent mental health providers. We didn't create a new medication or a new reimbursement model. We took the existing health plan infrastructure that a lot of you helped create. We took existing providers and we unlocked a lot of capacity. We took providers who didn't want to work for the system. We took the system that didn't work for providers. And we said, we'll go in the middle. As a result, I have a new white hair every single day, but that's okay, because the results speak for themselves. Access, member experience, quality, outcomes, interoperability, these are some of our key pillars and extremely important as we think about the shift of behavioral health from fee-for-service to value-based care. What does this mean? It means people in less than 2 minutes can find a provider who matches their preferences, takes their insurance, and has availability within days. Payers get the access and the outcomes that they need. And providers can accept insurance without dealing with any of the nonsense that comes with working from payers. No offense to anyone in this room. We work with many major payers across the country, cover over 100 million total lives. If you're Kaiser SoCal, you can send over 1,000 members a week, and all of them will have 3-day average access time to first offered appointment. We serve ages 5 and above. We've already helped over 5,000 children and adolescents for them in a year. This is the type of experience that every person should have, regardless of the insurance that they have. Even if you have good insurance, depending on the color of your skin, you are more or less likely to get access to mental health care if you need it. I know health equity is top of mind for many people in this room, and nowhere is it more important than for behavioral health. The results are not just bad, they are deadly. Black children are 2 times more likely to commit suicide than white children. I said mental health affects everyone, and that's true for our mothers. We have to take care of our moms. 1 in 4 will have depression during pregnancy. 1 in 5 will have postpartum. And while they're taking care of their newborns, only about 15% of them are going to get the care that they need. I always say you can't solve mental health without having a diverse network. The example I always like to give is someone will come and say, I need a female African-American therapist who can treat postpartum, is in network with Anthem, California, and by the way, I can only see them Saturday afternoon. Heard a few chuckles, as you know, it's basically impossible to find that. Raise your hand if you've ever been called the N-word. Raise your hand if you've ever been racially profiled for a robbery at knife point before you're even old enough to have an ID. Now do you understand why someone might want a therapist who looks like them, shared experiences, same sexual orientation? We have over 450,000 different permutations when you look at ethnicity, gender, sexual orientation, languages, specialties. We actually just added therapy modality, so that number is even bigger. And 98% of the time, we can get you a therapist matching exactly what you wanted, which is a big reason why we see that 99% therapeutic alliance. Access was the first, second, and third problem when I first started talking to the payers, and it still is for some payers. For us, access is foundational. Of course, we have 3-day average time to first offered appointment. Quality normally stops after those first 2 circles, for payers, for other groups. Where we spend a lot of our time is on those last 3. All providers have to be on our single EHR. We have a clinical quality scorecard measuring things like our providers canceling on patients, same-day documentation, all the way through your true measurement-based care, the PHQ, the GAD, Columbia Suicide Severity Rating Scale, Audit C for Alcohol, and the Therapeutic Alliance. We don't just say, hey, providers, go out and do this on your own. We give them a ton of clinical support. Again, we are a healthcare provider group. Whether that be clinical case consultations, we have licensed clinical quality coaches that can intervene if we see a provider struggling in a certain area. This is the type of support we need to give to our providers to ensure that we're getting high quality mental health care. The results speak for themselves. 76% of patients with a positive Columbia Suicide Severity Rating Scale indicate a reduction in suicidality within 90 days. For severe and moderately severe patients, we see a 30 to 40% reduction in PHQ and GAD within 6 sessions. One of my favorite stats that we have is that when you match a person to a provider of their preference based off ethnicity, you see 2 times better the results than when you don't. We all knew how important diversity was. We know how important health equity is. We now have the data to show just how important it is when it comes to mental health. You can't talk about mental health without talking about physical health. You can't talk about physical health without talking about mental health. Anyone out there thinking about healthcare trend, I'm going to spare you from raising your hand. But just remember, those people are 3 to 6 times more costly. Behavioral health can't be on an island. It has to be integrated with the rest of the healthcare ecosystem, especially primary care. For example, we have all the notes for our providers. We have all the outcome measures. We send that into care quality, and health systems can pull that directly into their EHR so that their primary care doctors can see the notes and see the data. You have to put the patient and the family at the center. Care has to be coordinated. Let's say someone's seeing one of our therapists, and they identify that they have to go to a higher level of care. Intensive outpatient program, residential treatment center. They get to hit the care coordination button, and we step in to help alleviate a lot of that burden from both the patient and the provider. This is an extremely powerful room. Many of you literally have the ability to impact mental health care for millions of people. So I'm going to end with one simple question. What are you going to do? Thank you.